Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News analysis by Shankar AS Academy for the date 26th August 2019. These are the list of articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been given along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions of Hindu newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is given in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Let's move on. For the first article analysis for the day, this discussion is based on the finding of the National Commission for the Protection of Child Rights with respect to mica mining in the states of Jharkhand and Bihar. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been given here for your reference. We have a National Commission for the Protection of Child Rights. This commission was set up in the year 2007. It is a statutory body that was established by the Commission for the Protection of Child Rights Act of 2005. Based on this act, there are specific functions for this commission. So now we will see some of the important functions. This commission examines and reviews the various safeguards that are provided for the protection of child rights under any law. It also has to examine all factors that inhibit the enjoyment of rights of children. Here the children could be those affected by exploitation, say for example, exploitation by child labor and also other vulnerabilities such as communal rights, maltreatment, natural disaster and so on. So the commission has to undertake and promote research related to child rights, and on its own it can inquire into the complaints related to the violations of child rights, or it can inquire by the submission of complaints by other persons also. So now these are the functions based on which the NCPCR has conducted a study to understand the issue of child labor in mica mining in the states of Bihar and Jharkhand. Earlier, an international child relief agency that works for the rights of children has reported that more than 22,000 children were employed as child laborers in the mica mining areas of Bihar and Jharkhand. This international agency is Tardezam. This agency has its headquarters in Switzerland. So the report by this international agency disclosed that even now child labor to this extent can be seen in mining industries in these states. So to understand the reality and to know the gravity of this issue, NCPCR has conducted a study where it has found that more than 5,000 children in the age group of 6 to 14 years are exploited as child labor. And this is found especially in the mica mining districts of Jharkhand and Bihar. So related to mica mining and the involvement of children, the noted districts are Koderma and Giridi districts in Jharkhand and Nawada district in Bihar. This means more than 5,000 children are involved in these three districts itself. So the overall number in all over the state could be much larger than this number. The children are used for selling of mica scrap and other mining related activities. And these are the main means of livelihood for many families in the concerned districts. That means if children in this poverty struck families did not work in mica mines and related activities, they will not be able to lead a basic life as they cannot buy the essential requirements like food, water and other essentials. In other words, poverty is the main reason that drives the parents to make their children to work. As a result of this, the children have abandoned education and the families were unable to realize and see the benefit of education for their children through the schools. Therefore, the NCPCR has recommended that the mining industry and its supply chain should be made free of child labor, and strict actions has to be taken against the buyers of scrap from children. By the suggestion of taking strict action against the buyers, the idea is that they are trying to demotivate the children and their parents that nobody is going to buy the mica scrap from them. So the parents will think involving the children is almost not useful. But this idea has some negatives also, because without addressing poverty, this issue may not stop in long run. And also it may lead to a situation where parents may sell the scraps that are collected by the children instead of directly involving the children in selling. So there has to be more credible mechanism that supports these families financially, and at some time it should also encourage the parents to send their children to school. So now let us see few safeguards available for children against child labor. Our constitution provides the first safeguard. Article 24 of Indian Constitution prohibits children below the age of 14 years to work in any factory or mine or in any other hazardous employment. Also, the Child Labor Prohibition Regulation Act of 1986 bans employing children who have not completed 14 years of age. We should also know that after the Child Labor Prohibition and Regulation Amendment Act of 2016, the Principal Act also prohibits employment of children in the age group of 14 to 18 years in certain works. These works are mentioned in the schedule of the Principal Act. The schedule also mentions the term mines. This means even the children up to 18 years shall not work in mines. Here when we say Principal Act, we mean the Child Labor Prohibition and Regulation Act of 1986. So now let us see few facts about the mica mineral in India. India is one of the largest producer of mica. The news article mentions that Bihar and Jharkhand are the main producing states. This is with respect to the production capacity. So what is the share of total resources of mica in the state? In terms of availability of these resources, Andhra Pradesh has around 41% of mica resources, and just around 3% of the mica resources are found in Bihar and Jharkhand together. But they are found to exploit the ores and produce mica. That is why they are the main states in terms of production capacity, though the availability of resources is comparatively lower than Andhra Pradesh. The news article also mentions that mica is used in buildings. That is, they are used in building and construction materials. They are also used in electronics. That is, they are used in electronic components such as pyrometers, radar systems, medical electronics, etc. And then they are also used as a part in capacitors, electrical insulators, thermal conductors, and also in electrical heating wire. And then it is also used in paints and cosmetics also, because mica is known to add glittering effect in them. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. The practice question displayed here will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is based on this open editorial, that is about the repeated Kerala deluge or severe flood. The article is authored by Madhav Ghadgil, who was the chairman of the Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel. This panel is also called as the Ghadgil Commission, which submitted its report to the Union Environment Ministry in 2011. In 2018, Kerala witnessed devastating floods and landslides, which resulted in huge financial losses and human tragedies. According to the author, the people believed that it was once in a century tragedy, and so normalcy would return soon. But again, this repeated in 2019 with a series of intense floods, landslides, financial losses, and human tragedies. This made people to realize that it is unwise to continue the business as usual, and it was time for them to think about new options before them. So, what are the alternatives that are available? The alternatives are available in the recommendations of Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel. Here the author notes that the recommendations would not have preempted or prevented the intense rainfall, but it would have definitely reduced the scale of devastation that was caused by the downpour. The author says that all the recommendations of the commission were based on careful examination of facts. Also, the policies which were prescribed were within the framework of our constitutional duties and laws. The report did not ask for any new legislation, but it just suggested to follow the existing laws that are related to environmental protection. It also suggested to follow the devolution of powers. The devolution of powers is from the state government to the Gram Sabha and to the ward level. The author says that the commission suggested this because Kerala leads the country in democratic devolution of power. That is, Kerala has a strong local self-government. To substantiate this point, the author cites one example. It is the Plachimada agitation against the Coca-Cola company in Palakkad district of Kerala. In the early 2000s, the Plachimada Panchayat had cancelled the license of Coca-Cola because the company polluted and depleted groundwater reserves. It also led to drying up of wells, and eventually it impacted agriculture and livelihoods. But the company counter-argued that the state government granted the license to the company, and panchayat was subordinate to the state government, so it cannot cancel the license. But the Kerala High Court ruled in favor of Plachimada Panchayat, saying that the grassroots institutions have authority to decide on the course of development in their own locality. After this, the Kerala legislature unanimously passed a law asking the company to pay due compensation to the panchayat for the losses. The author says that Kerala has also been at the forefront of the country's literary mission of the late 1980s. The state pioneered in panchayat level resource mapping of land, soil, water bodies, etc. This was followed by the People's Planning Campaign that attempted to involve every panchayat in the preparation of a panchayat development report. So these are the reasons the author gives to say that Kerala has a strong local self-government. Then the author notes that the Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel called for a model of conservation and development that are compatible with each other. It sought to replace the prevailing develop recklessly, conserve thoughtlessly pattern. It wanted to replace this with develop sustainably, conserve thoughtfully pattern. So, this fine-tuning of development practices would require the full involvement of local communities. This would also ensure that no development or conservation priorities would be imposed on the people. But the recommendations by this report were considered as impractical and it was not implemented. The implementation of the recommendations would have helped to achieve the bottom-up democratic process of safeguarding ecological sensitivity, safeguarding the biodiversity and the safeguarding of water tower of peninsular India, which is the Western Ghats. Then one of the most important recommendation was to demarcate areas within the Western Ghats as ecologically sensitive zones under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. The author says that in line with the National Forest Policy, the commission decided to assign 60% of the total area of Western Ghats in Kerala as a zone of highest ecological sensitivity or ESZ1. This would also include wildlife sanctuaries and national parks. The commission also proposed two indicators of sensitivity. One was elevation and the other was slope. In Kerala, rainfall increases rapidly with elevation. So, high rainfall and steep slopes causes localities to be vulnerable to landslides. So, areas prone to landslides would come under ESZ1. Then a third indicator was also given for this. It was the extent and quality of natural vegetation. We know that landslides are controlled in areas where there is intact natural vegetation. This is because the roots bind the soil. So, any disturbance to such vegetation would cause landslides in any locality that has steep slopes and when a locality experiences high rainfall. Here by disturbance, the author means quarrying or mining, replacement of natural vegetation by new plantations or leveling of the land using heavy machinery or even the construction of houses and roads. So, the commission recommended that such activities that causes disturbances to be avoided under ESZ1 areas. The author says that if the recommendations had been implemented, the extent of intensity of landslides and the losses in Kerala would have been much lower. So, the author says that it is time to look into the recommendations again. For that, we need participation of people, especially at the grassroots levels. Because democracy is the active involvement of citizens in governing the country at all levels, most importantly at the local level. So, the Kerala High Court's judgment, which upheld that local bodies have the authority to decide on the course of development in their own locality, must be made operational across the country. So, the author says conservation of nature should not be merely regulatory, but it should include positive incentives such as service charges also. The author also suggests that we must hand over economic activities like quarrying to agencies like Kudumbashree groups that are accountable to local communities. Here, Kudumbashree is a women's self-help group in Kerala. The author concludes by saying that the sovereign people are the real rulers of India. So, we must engage ourselves more actively in the governance of the country. This can be done at the local levels. And we have to lead it to a path of people-friendly, that is development oriented, and nature friendly, that is conservation oriented development. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. This practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is about the blue whale. The syllabus with which the discussion can be linked has been given here for your reference. The article states that a research scientist at the Koringa Marine Museum has assembled the skeletal remains of dead blue whales. By this, the research scientist has configured or put together a life-size skeleton of the blue whale. Now, also know that the Koringa Marine Museum is in the state of Andhra Pradesh, and the skeletal remains were collected from the Machilipatnam coast. So now, let us see what is special in these blue whales that we are discussing it today. Blue whales are the largest animal in the world. Even it is the largest animal ever to have lived on our planet. Blue whales can grow to be about 100 feet or 30.5 meters in length, and they weigh around 160 tons to 200 tons, which is equal to approximately 33 elephants. So you can just imagine how big they are. Even the newborn blue whales are about 23 feet or 7 meters long, and they roughly weigh about 30 tons. So even the newborns are bigger in size. These blue whales are mottled bluish gray in color, as you can see in this picture. These giant blue whales are found in all oceans. So the blue whale is a cosmopolitan species, which means it is found all over the world. According to IUCN, they are absent or not found in some regional seas such as the Mediterranean Sea, Okhotsk Sea and Bering Sea. Some of the interesting facts about these blue whales are that, as they are the largest animal to have ever lived on Earth, which is of 100 feet length, it is said that they are even larger than dinosaurs. One another interesting fact is that a blue whale heart is the size of a small car. It is said that the blue whale aorta, which is the main blood vessel, is so large that a human can crawl through it. Then the blue whale blows, which is called as pouts, consists of air and water. And the spout rise about 30 feet or 9.1 meters height. See, the whales breathe air just like humans. However, as they live in water, breathing is a little more difficult for the blue whales than it is for us. Most whales can hold their breath for prolonged periods of time. So to take a breath, whales must swim to the surface, and they have to exhale through their blowhole. This action of exhaling air is called as spouting, which is also called as blowing. The spouts help people to identify whales. This is because blue whales have the highest spout, which can rise up to 30 feet or 9.1 meters. Then one another interesting thing is that these blue whales are louder than jet engine. A blue whale calls reach 188 decibels, while a jet reaches 140 decibels only. It is also said that their low frequency whistle can be heard for hundreds of miles, and the whistle is probably used to attract other blue whales. We know that whales are the top of the food chain, so they have an important role in the overall health of the marine environment. Like other large whales, even the blue whales are also threatened by environmental change, including habitat loss and toxics. The blue whales are harmed by ship strikes. Many are injured or even they die each year from impacts with large ships. They are also harmed by becoming entangled in fishing gears. Blue whales have few predators, but they are known to fall victim to attacks by sharks and killer whales. Then one another reason for the decline in the blue whale population was that the blue whale was subjected to major commercial hunting in the past. The intensive hunting of blue whales, which started in the late 19th century, brought this species to the verge of extinction by the 1960s. After that, it was given international protection. This is because hunting of the blue whale is now prohibited by the International Whaling Commission since 1966. But today, the most significant threat to this species may be the declining availability of krill. Krill is also a marine animal, and it is the primary food source for the blue whales. Then also know that the species is listed on Appendix 1 of the Conservation on International Trade in Wild Species of Fauna and Flora, that is CITES. Then it is listed on Appendix 1 of the Convention on the Conservation of Migratory Species of Wild Animals also, that is in CMS. then it is also listed as endangered on the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. Then if we consider India, the blue whale is protected by the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 under Schedule 1 of the Act. And the IUCN has noted that after the effective implementation of conservation measures, there are signs that the blue whale population is slowly recovering. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is about India's compliance to one of the data standards initiatives of the International Monetary Fund. The syllabus relevant for the analysis for this news article has been given here for your reference. This news article mentions about a report that is released by IMF on India. This report talks about how India observed the requirements under the Special Data Dissemination Standard or SDDS initiative. This report is titled as Annual Observance Report of the Special Data Dissemination Standard for 2018. This SDDS is one of the data standard initiatives of International Monetary Fund. The article mentions that abiding or adhering to the SDDS requirements is a practice that is mandatory for all the IMF members. It has stated that India has failed to comply with multiple requirements under SDDS. This has happened in spite of monthly reminders by IMF. These monthly reminders were sent to India by way of monthly reports. These monthly reports are sent by IMF to inform the SDDS subscriber countries about their observance with these standards. But it is found that other comparable countries or other comparable economies in the BRICS framework have maintained the near impeccable record. That is, other countries in the BRICS grouping have complied with the requirements almost in a near perfect manner. Then the article also compares India's own performance in the present time with respect to the time till 2016. By this comparison, one can say that India's compliance level in 2017 and 2018 is not on par with its own performance in the years till 2016. Generally, we can observe three kinds of deviations with the requirements of SDDS. One is with respect to delays in data dissemination. There are more than 20 data categories under SDDS that helps in reflecting the economic and financial situation of the country, and delays have been observed in some parts of these data categories. The second deviation is with respect to listing the data categories in the advance release calendars. The term advance release calendar is used in statistical systems where it refers to a statement on the schedule of release of data in terms of periodicity and timeliness. It projects the policy of the government regarding the release of statistics according to a pre-announced schedule and the availability of the statistics according to the announced calendar. For example, if the government clearly mentions when it will be releasing all the data categories and if government follows that calendar, that means government is following the SDDS requirements superbly. But the news article mentions that in around three categories, India has not mentioned a prescribed entry in its advance release calendar. Then the article mentions that India's relative non-compliance with respect to some of the SDDS requirements is a recent phenomenon. And IMF has stated that these deviations are non-serious in nature. Note that if IMF considers the deviations as serious, then some specific procedures would be adopted against the particular member country. These procedures are to make the country to adhere to the SDDS standards. So now let us see the comment of the Deputy Director from the Department of Economic Affairs with respect to the matter. He has stated that the non-compliance issues are a result of few technical glitches. These glitches were because of various changes made in 2018 in the website of Ministry of Finance. As per the standards, Finance Ministry website usually hosts the National Summary Data page or the NSDP. Every member country will host this NSDP page under SDDS. This summary page has to be hosted by Ministry of Finance. But in India, some of the data for NSDP were available in websites other than Finance Ministry's website. The publishing of NSDP information in Ministry of Finance website was with delays. Though the data is not available in the Ministry of Finance's website, most of the date were found in timely manner in other websites of the government. This is one of the reasons why IMF termed such deviations are of non-serious nature. However, some of the experts, more importantly the former acting chairman of the National Statistical Commission, has criticized that India's deviations were because of inadequate attention paid to data dissemination. Also, the present data collection efforts are not matching enough to ensure the quality of data. He also mentioned that India's performance in providing information under the Data Quality Assurance Framework is also patchy, irregular, and poorly edited. This article may be referring to the Data Quality Assessment Framework of IMF. This framework was earlier launched in 2001, but it was revised in 2003. This framework is an organizing model of the IMF's activity regarding the data modules of the report on the observance of standards and codes. And with respect to the employment data, the link given by the government directs to the data collected in 2011-12, which was collected by the 68th round of National Sample Survey. This means that the data on employment has not been updated for the present time. He has also stated that the statistical systems in the present times is not up to the previous high quality standards, and the systems also lacks credibility. These are some of the comments with respect to the India's relative non-compliance on SDDS mechanism of IMF. Now let us see some data standard initiatives taken by IMF. In the year 1994, there was a financial crisis in Mexico. After this financial crisis of Mexico, the international financial community recognized the essential role of data transparency for meeting the challenges and the risks of globalization. It also recognized the role of data transparency in reducing the likelihood of financial crisis. There was a need for more timely dissemination of reliable macroeconomic and financial data, and there was a need for an improved early warning system so that a quick response can be given to such financial shocks. Therefore, IMF has introduced the Special Data Dissemination Standard for its member countries. It aimed at guiding the member countries in providing the economic and financial data to the public. The SDDS identifies four dimensions of data dissemination. They are the data coverage, then periodicity or the frequency and the timeliness of the data coverage, and data reporting, and then access to data by the public, and then finally integrity and quality of the disseminated data. This SDDS was introduced as the first tier of data standard initiatives. The second tier was introduced in 1997. It is called as General Data Dissemination System. It aimed to provide assistance and framework for some countries, so that in some time these countries will be able to meet the requirements under SDDS. The General Data Dissemination System or GDDS system has been superseded by eGDDS system in the year 2015. Then as a third measure, the IMF introduced SDDS Plus in 2012. This is to further reinforce and supplement data standard initiatives. Its purpose is to assist the member countries for the publication of economic and financial statistical data comprehensively and also in a timely manner. The data given under SDDS Plus has to be accessible and reliable, particularly in the face of continuing economic and financial integration in the world. The main aim of introducing SDDS Plus is to address the gaps that were identified during the global financial crisis of 2007-2009. The SDDS Plus is also open for all SDDS subscribers. Right now, India is subscriber only to SDDS. But we can see countries such as US, Canada, France, Japan are subscribers to SDDS Plus. So with this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. This practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the last discussion for the day, which is with respect to the Advisory Board for Banking Frauds. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been given here for your reference. The news article states that the Central Vigilance Commission has constituted the Advisory Board for Banking Frauds. or in short ABBF. This board is to examine bank frauds of over rupees 50 crores and to recommend action against it. It will be headed by former Vigilance Commissioner of Central Vigilance Commission. This ABBF was formed after reconstituting and renaming the Advisory Board on Bank, Commercial and Financial Frauds of Central Vigilance Commission. This ABBF is formed in consultation with the RBI. It would function as the first level of examination of all large fraud cases before references are made to the investigative agencies by the respective public sector banks. This board will have four members including the chairman. Their tenure would be for a period of 2 years. Its jurisdiction would be confined to those cases that involves the level of officers of general manager and above in the public sector banks when there is a allegation of fraud against them. The board will periodically carry out fraud analysis in the financial system and it will give inputs to the RBI for policy formation related to the fraud. The required logistic and analytical support along with the necessary funding to the board will be provided by the RBI. The banks or lenders will refer all large fraud cases above rupees 50 crore to the board. Then the concerned bank would take further actions on the matter based on the recommendations of the board. The article also says that the CBI may also refer any case to the board when the CBI has any issue or difficulty in technical matters with the concerned bank. For checking the bank frauds, in July 2019, the government had issued framework for timely detection, reporting, investigation relating to large value bank frauds to public sector banks. It stated that all accounts exceeding rupees 50 crore, if classified as non-performing assets, can be examined by banks from the angle of possible fraud. Then a report has to be placed before the bank's committee for review of NPAs on the findings of this investigation. Actually, there is a distinction between a bank fraud and an NPA. A bank fraud is a criminal offense, whereas a non-performing asset or NPA is a loan or advance in which the interests or installments of the principal amount remain as overdue for over 90 days. Now, based on this framework which was issued in July, this ABBF has been constituted by Central Vigilance Commission. So, now let us see some facts about Central Vigilance Commission. It was established in the year 1964. It was established with the aim of addressing corrupt practices within the government. It gives advice and guidance to central government agencies in the field of vigilance. It was set up on the recommendations of Committee on Prevention of Corruption, which is famously known as Santhanam Committee. The Central Vigilance Commission is responsible for monitoring all vigilance activities under the Union Government. Also know that the Central Vigilance Commission is a statutory body under the Central Vigilance Act of 2003. And it is also an autonomous body and it is not under any ministry. It was conceived to be the apex vigilance institution, which is free of control from any executive authority and which can monitor all vigilance activity under the central government. With this, we have come to the end of this article discussion. This practice question will be discussed in the next session. Moving on to the last session for the day, that is the practice questions discussion session. In this first question, two statements have been given and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement states, the National Commission for the Protection of Child Rights is a constitutional body. Now, this statement is wrong because the National Commission for the Protection of Child Rights, that is the NCPCR, is a statutory body because it was established by the Commission for the Protection of Child Rights Act of 2005. So, we know that it is not established based on the provisions in Constitution. So, it is not a constitutional body. This statement is wrong. If you see the next statement, it states the commission can inquire into the violation of child rights by suo motu. Now, during our discussion, we saw that one of the functions of NCPCR is to inquire into the complaints about the violation of child rights, non-implementation of laws, policies for the protection of child rights. We also saw that it can inquire on its own without anyone making any formal complaint or reporting of violations to the commission. Now, this inquiry is called as suo motu, which is inquiring on its own. So this statement is correct. Here statement 2 is the correct statement. So the final answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Now this next question states, in which of the following state the share of mica with respect to the country's total mica resources is maximum? 4 states have been given: Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Bihar, Jharkhand. During our discussion, we saw that Bihar and Jharkhand together account for 3% of mica resources found in the country. And we also saw that Andhra Pradesh accounts for 41% of mica resource found in the country, which is the maximum. So the correct answer to this question is option A, Andhra Pradesh. Also know that the second state which has most mica resources is Rajasthan, which is followed by Odisha. This question is based on Special Data Dissemination Standard. It states, the question asks that this data standard initiative is established by which of the following organizations? 4 organizations have been given, and based on today's discussion, we clearly know that the Special Data Dissemination Standard or SDDS initiative is established by International Monetary Fund or IMF. During discussion, we have seen some important data standard initiatives taken by IMF to bring data transparency in member countries. And in the year 1996, it introduced Special Data Dissemination Standard. So the correct answer to this question is option B, International Monetary Fund. This question is with respect to blue whales. 3 statements have been given and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement states, they are found in Indian Ocean only. Now, during our discussion, we saw that the blue whale is a cosmopolitan species, which means it is found all over the world. And we also saw that these blue whales are found in all oceans except in some regional seas such as the Mediterranean Sea, Okhotsk Sea and Bering Sea. So this means this statement is wrong. Now, as the first statement is wrong, you can eliminate option A and option B. Now, the second statement states, it is listed as critically endangered by the IUCN Red List. Now, as of now, it is listed as endangered in the IUCN Red List of threatened species. This is because of the effective implementation of conservation measures, which are helping in the slow recovery of the blue whale population. So, this statement is also wrong, which means statement 3 is the correct statement and option C is the correct answer to this question. Now, also know that it is protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. This next question is based on Advisory Board for Banking Frauds. 2 statements have been given and we have to choose the correct statement. First statement states, it was constituted by Central Vigilance Commission in consultation with the RBI. Yes, this statement is correct. It was constituted by Central Vigilance Commission. It was formed after reconstituting and renaming the Advisory Board on Bank, Commercial and Financial Frauds. And it was formed after the consultation with the RBI. So, this statement is correct. The second statement states, its objective is to examine large bank frauds of over rupees 50 crore and recommend action. Now, this statement is also correct. Because this board was formed based on the framework that was issued by the central government, which stated that all accounts exceeding rupees 50 crore, if classified as non-performing assets, can be examined by banks from the angle of possible fraud. For this purpose only, this board was constituted. So, this statement is also correct. Here, both the statements are correct. So, the final correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. This next question is based on Central Vigilance Commission and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement states, it was constituted based on the recommendations of the Gadgil Commission. Now, this statement is wrong because we saw Gadgil Commission with respect to Kerala flood open editorial. In that, we mentioned that Madhav Gadgil was the chairman of Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel, which was also called as Gadgil Commission. So, this means Gadgil Commission was based on Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel. It was an environment related panel. But we know that Central Vigilance Commission is set up for addressing the corrupt practices within the government. So that means Central Vigilance Commission has to be based on a committee which was on the prevention of corruption. And this committee on prevention of corruption is called as Santanam Committee, not Gadgil Commission. So this statement is wrong. Now the second statement states, It is an autonomous statutory body. Now, first we have to, in this statement, two things have been given. First, we have to know whether it is an autonomous body, and second, whether it is a statutory body. Yes, it is a autonomous body because CVC was conceived to be the apex vigilance institution, which is free of control from any executive authority for monitoring all vigilance activity under the central government. Now, second, whether it is a statutory body. Yes, it is a statutory body. It was given statutory status based upon the promulgation of an ordinance by the president. This ordinance made the Central Vigilance Commission a multi-member commission in the year 1998. Then in 2003, the Central Vigilance Bill was passed by both the houses of the parliament, and the president gave assent in September 2003. So, based on this, the Central Vigilance Commission Act of 2003 came into effect. Now, under this act, the Central Vigilance Commission continues to be a statutory body. So, this statement is correct. The third statement states it comes under Ministry of Home Affairs. Now, during our discussion, we mentioned that it does not come under any ministry. So, this statement is wrong. The question asks for the correct statement. Here, statement 2 is the only correct statement. So, the final correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Now, let us see one mains question based on GS paper 2. Kerala has witnessed back-to-back floods that resulted in heavy financial losses and human tragedies. In this context, discuss the relevance of Gadgil Commission report and the importance of a bottom-up approach in the conservation of nature. Now, with respect to this first statement, you can say that in the year 2018, Kerala witnessed devastating floods and landslides which resulted in huge financial losses and human tragedies. And this also repeated in 2019. Now, the actual question is, discuss the relevance of Gadgil Commission report and the importance of bottom-up approach in conservation of nature. So, now for this, you can say that the Gadgil Commission report, which is the Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel report, has given some recommendations based on which, if it was implemented, the losses could have been reduced. Now, the recommendations include the devolution of powers from the state government to the Gram Sabha and ward level. Now, this is known as the bottom-up approach. Now, this recommendation was given because Kerala leads the country in democratic devolution of power and it has a strong local self-government. And to substantiate this point, you can mention the Plachimada agitation against the Coca-Cola company. Then you can mention the statement given by the Kerala High Court, which stated that the grassroots institutions have authority to decide on the course of development in their own locality. Now, this reiterates the importance of a bottom-up approach, that is the role of people in conservation of nature. Then you can also say that this report also recommended to replace the prevailing develop recklessly, conserve thoughtlessly pattern with develop sustainably, conserve thoughtfully. Then there were also recommendations to demarcate areas within Western Ghats as ecologically sensitive zones under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Then you can also say this demarcation will be based on the indicators of sensitivity, which are elevation, slope, and the extent and quality of natural vegetation. Now, this is only possible when people engage themselves more actively in the governance of the country and lead it to a path of people-friendly and nature-friendly development. Then finally, you can also add your own viewpoints based on today's discussion. With this, we have come to the end of article discussions and question answer discussion sessions. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.